Good morning, and welcome to a very peaceful morning here on Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Gert on camera with me, and we've come to investigate, as I promised yesterday, one den site per drive, or one old hyena den site per drive. Yesterday, apparently, Brent and Gert saw Madam, the matriarch of our clan, hanging around Philemon's dip, which got me thinking that perhaps, maybe, just maybe, we were mistaken about where the hyena den is actually moved to, and that they might actually be right under our noses at the old Philemon's cutline den. Unfortunately, as you can see, nothing hyena-shaped, at least, has been around this den site for a while, and in fact it is completely empty. Maybe some elephants have come through, but that is about it. So we'll have to continue on, and we'll just keep checking the hyena dens each and every single morning. Now, if you are joining us for the first time, this is a live safari, which means that everything you are seeing is happening right here in the northeastern corner of South Africa. Not only are we live, but we are also interactive, which means that you can send your questions through on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And with that being said and covered, let's go and see what else we can find. Now, I'm not all on my own this morning, or at least Gert and myself are not all alone this morning. And we have James out on a new vehicle character to add to our show, but I'm not going to tell you any more about that. I'm going to let James do it himself. Nevertheless, James and Brian, Kirsty's hat, of course, keeping my head lovely and warm, on a morning that's not too chilly. I think we're facing the calm before the storm at the moment. There's apparently a brutal cold front on its way, bringing snow to the Drakensberg Mountains and icy cold temperatures for us. But for now, the warm air is being pushed ahead of the cold front, and it's not too bad. It's in fact so warm that I haven't even bothered with a hot water bottle this morning, so you must know. This is probably one of the sort of warmest mornings that we've experienced. They tell us that it is 14 degrees centigrade, which is in sort of almost 60 Fahrenheit, so really not too bad. While we continue on, I'm going to pass you over to the capable hands of Mr. Henry so that he can tell you all about his new vehicle.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the boat safari today. We are sitting on a new vehicle today. There is an elephant, obviously, about to have something of an eat, and I refer to this car that we're on, the Mahindra, as the boat because it is so very large. Brian sailing at the back there on camera. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, Dave.
How are your sea legs today?
Very sturdy.
Wonderful. My name is James Hendry, if you happen to wonder. That's not the voice of the animal you can see talking to you. I'm sitting in the car. That is an elephant bull. He's just chased a little group of elephants back across the road. I think he's probably in must, and they're probably a bit nervous of him. He's
good
a magnificent fellow, isn't he? So let's just watch him going. We are just as live as Jamie is, which means that you are welcome and encouraged indeed to talk to us through the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live is the best way to do it. That's on Twitter, of course. If you don't know what Twitter is, fear not. It's very simple. Just feel how silently he moves. There's very little sound coming from around him. And he, of course, to my mind, is the real royalty of the bush. You can say what you like about lions, but when a big elephant bull like this comes knocking about, nothing gets in his way. He's probably, I would say, I mean, he's, you know, an elephant is never fully grown. They grow until they die. But he's an adult bull. He's not as big as he's going to get. He's probably about 25 years old, I'd say, 25 to 30, so he will get bigger. But he's probably sitting at about 5.5 tons and standing about 10 feet at the shoulder. and all to the right-hand side of where you can see. You won't be able to hear this, but I can hear a rumbling, a deep rumbling from the rest of the herd that he's tailing. And as we arrived here, there was a cow, a very young cow, and a calf hurtling across the road in that ridiculous kind of power walking fashion that elephants have. They can't run, of course, they must power walk. And they, I think, were trying to get away from him. So he'll be tailing the herd, trying to see if there's an estrus female. Trying to smell if he's in must. Must, of course, the breeding time of bull elephants. Their testosterone levels go through the roof, and then they start to trail the herds and look for an estrus female. And it's very easy to tell if they are in must, of course, because they have this sort of smelly urine that drips from them continuously. It's called, rather appropriately, green penis syndrome. Brian, look behind us. Look at that, everyone. There come the son. What a great joy and privilege it is to be able to wake up every morning, go out before that, well, today, red orb comes up over the eastern horizon, and enjoy the dawn light. Truly the best time of day, just before the sun comes up. And then again, my other favorite time of the day, just after it's set, before dark. Full of expectation for the day. And we'll see what happens. I'm just going to quickly call these elephants in. Station says a breeding herd of elephants and Vuyatela access at junction power lines. Animals are mobile in an easterly direction. Southeast, northeasterly direction. Isn't that pretty? No, I didn't see them, Tex. Tex is just saying that he's got some leopard tracks that are going towards the Vuyatela Dam. It's quite exciting. We'll go and give him a hand just now there. Okay, copy, thanks. Stunning. Let's go and have one more look at these elephants, everybody. Now, Sandy, you ask a very valid question about what would happen if an elephant bull dies, or when an elephant bull dies, because eventually he must, like all living things. And you want to know if hyenas and lions will have a go at him, will they'll eat him. Of course they will, definitely. It's not easy for them to get into the skin, of course. It's more than half an inch thick in some places. But yes, certainly, lions and hyenas will eventually devour his carcass. Nothing will go to waste out here. There he is. Just going to give him some space. He's a big fellow, that. He will fill out. You'll find that when he's about 35 to 40 years old, he will fill out. So his muscles will become larger. And he'll get a kind of a more solid appearance to him. I mean, he's very solid now. It's not to cast any aspersions on his current build. Now, Shamsun, you've noticed that there is some moisture flowing down his face, behind, between his ears and his eyes. And you're saying, is that a sign of must? It isn't. It's a sign of stress, which in turn is probably a sign of must. So you will find many elephants like this who are streaming between the, it's called a temporal gland, between the eye and the ear. They do stream from that gland when they feel a sense of stress or discomfort. And I think that's brought on by the incredible levels of testosterone coursing about his body. But it is a mistake to think that any elephant that has that streaming temporal gland is in must. If they're socially stressed, nutritionally stressed, heat stressed, just generally upset, they will always stream from that gland. He's not streaming particularly badly from it. Just a little bit there. He doesn't smell particularly strongly like he's in must, to be honest. But I can just see a little bit of moisture between his back legs, which indicates to me that he probably is. We'll just sneak a little bit forward. See how he reacts to us. He seems to be relatively comfortable. I love the long hairs they have on the tail. And you can often get that little bit of white above their eyes like he's got there, and I'm not sure what that is. I think it's a kind of bit like sleep in the eye, to be honest. And it always seems to form just above. Yeah, he doesn't seem to be in full must. There's definitely an element of it there, but he's not in full must. That's why he looks pretty calm, I think. And you can just see the colour of his face changing there. You see that? Just changing as the sun starts to bathe his forehead. It was an unusually warm night last night for us, so I don't think he's going to need to leap into the sun to try and warm up too much. He really is pretty warm for the middle of winter, 15 degrees Celsius or so, which is around about 57 degrees Fahrenheit. Isn't that lovely, the way his face has turned oranged? Just as the sun has come up, so a slight breeze has risen from the southeast as the air has started to heat and move with the sun's heat. And there's a lovely smell. It is a wintry smell. It's a smell of dry leaf litter on the ground and a bit of mixed in with a bit of dust, and it's really lovely. He's almost gone pink, hasn't he, Brian?
Yeah.
Pink elephant.
Mm-hmm. You need to watch out for those.
Yeah, you've got to watch out for a pink elephant. Take a deep breath in, everybody. Inhale the dawn. A bit of dust, leaf litter, and even a bit of smoke. And the breeze I'm talking rubbish isn't coming from the southeast, it's actually coming from the northwest. And in the northwest, of course, many villages, and those villages will now just be waking as well, and people will be lighting fires to do their cooking, and that has just touched the air with a very comforting smell. Let me sneak a little bit forward from here, see if we can't get a slightly better view. He's a little bit nervous of us. I'm going to try and get him with the sun behind him, but I don't think I'm going to succeed because he's moving in the wrong direction. Let's just stop here for a last look. We'll watch him disappear off into the bush, and then we'll head up the road. And what we're going to do is drive to the sort of northern boundary and then head south. Obviously, if you're on the northern boundary, you have to go south eventually. And the idea is going to be to see if we can't find some tracks of either Shadow and her cub, or perhaps Karula, the queen of Juma, our 12-year-old female leopard. Oh, that's nice, Brian. Look what he's doing. As is what elephants and every other animal I ever look at do.
Tradition,
yes. Anyway, so the idea is going to be to look for those female leopards and their babies. Well, we'll see if we are lucky. An elephant will produce more than 100 litres of urine in a day, of course, and a big elephant bull like this. Now, wait for this, everybody. 150 kilograms of dung in a day. Now, that in pounds is about 350 pounds. 350 pounds of fertile dung. Imagine if you were to take all 15,000 plus elephants out of the Kruger National Park, the effect it would have on the vegetation, both from a fertilization point of view and from a utilization point of view. So much less would get processed through that giant sort of composting machine that you can see in front of us. And it would profoundly change the landscape. Right, well, this elephant is going to wander off into the dawn light. Let's go back across to Jamie and see what she's managed to find. That is the thumb.
Oh, judging by the tracks that are absolutely everywhere this morning, the elephants have been wandering about high and low on Juma. So while James is searching for the lovely female leopards of this area, Herbert, Taxon and I are double-checking for Tingana. Now, I have a slightly embarrassing confession to make. I dreamt last night that I heard a leopard calling, and I can't remember exactly what the dream was, but it was there was a leopard that we had to go and find, and we were following the sound of his rasping, sawing sound. And I think we were successful. However, it appears as though there was actually a leopard sawing outside my house and that it wasn't just a dream. So Tingana, the big dominant male leopard. There we go, look, there's more elephants for us to have a look at. Definitely, it appears as though it was not in fact a dream and that there was a leopard wandering about, and it seems as though it was the dominant male of this area. Also wandering off into the bush. The elephants, apparently James's were a little bit nervous. These lot are fine, but I think they're on a mission towards a dam which is not too far away from here. This is an area south of our Traverse region, so we cannot drive in this direction. It's also one of Karula's preferred spots, so I'm checking carefully to see if she hasn't wandered across. The difficulty is, I mean, let me show you something roughly. Without going too far off the beaten track, if we have a look at the side of the road here, which is generally the best place to look for leopard tracks, because it's where the cars, the vehicles haven't moved across, you can just have a look at what sort of an impact elephant tracks have. They flatten it completely, and if a leopard that walks with a light step as it is, if a leopard had walked across there before the elephants, there's a very good chance that we wouldn't see those tracks. There you go, you can see how obscured everything is. And that combined with vehicle traffic makes life a little bit more tricky. Luckily we have the master tracker Herbert, who's been responsible for some incredible leopard sightings recently. We've got him on the case to see if he can't find Tingana. He's also just called in that there are lots of hyena tracks on Central Road. And I did hear a hyena calling from that direction. So maybe, just maybe, there's still hope for our hyena den. And we know that Herbert is looking, searching high and low. He's checked all of the area where they used to be around Aubrey's Road. And he tells us that they're most definitely gone. Perhaps all is not lost. Sure, okay. Now, Christopher, who is one of our regular viewers, was wondering whether we have any further updates on the movements of Sandile. Now, we need to go back in time a little bit to explain what happened with Sandile. A good few months ago, Sandile, who was Shadow's son, so Karula's daughter's son, her grandson, was just starting to Shadow had actually started mating earlier than would be considered to be normal for a mother leopard. And he, as a result, was forced to fend for himself more and more frequently. Now we're fortunate in that we're in a very protected area, but on the outskirts of this protected area, there are multiple villages and communities with, as is anywhere, with a problem with feral dogs or stray dogs. And poor Sandile very successfully hunted what may well have been his biggest prey at that point, but unfortunately turned out to be a dog. And the dog, after it was taken away and tested, turned out to have rabies, which is very, very common for the township specials, as we call them, the township dogs. So sadly, it meant that usually, under the law of the country, Sandile would have had to have been put down. However, there was a concerted effort to try and prevent that from happening, and very fortunately the state vet agreed to put him into quarantine and to basically use him as a test to see if animals exposed to the rabies virus could actually be vaccinated, treated, and then released back into the wild. So after an internment of close to 8 months, Sandile was released on the 5th of May and has been wandering around, monitored very closely by a collar that sits on his neck and sends out infrequent GPS coordinates as to where he may be. So the last we heard was that he was very close to the Simbambili fence line, so to the north of Simbambili, which is to the northwest of Juma. He caught something, or he was sharing a kill with a female, and I'm not sure which female it was. Might have been Sakani, could have been any of them. And he took one look at the vehicles approaching the sighting and booked out of there. He ran away. He's no longer used to the presence of safari vehicles. Now, I have a confession to make. I think we nearly found Sandile the other day when we were searching for a way to get into the Matimba male lion sighting on their buffalo kill. I had a kudu going absolutely frantic next to me, barking their deep bark alarm call. And I suspect, I searched and searched and I couldn't find the reason for this kudu's alarm call, but it was very close to the Arethusa airstrip. And I suspect that it was Sandile. I don't know, it's a suspicion. I think it was him, and I think he ran away from me the moment he saw me. Now, the latest update was that he was in Picanini, Utah, which is a part of the Sabi Sands around Simbambili. Hopefully he will at some point move in our direction. However, it does seem as though he's exceptionally scared of vehicles at this point, and it may be a long time before he readjusts to their presence. While we continue on towards Cheetah Plains and just double check that Tingana hasn't crossed out of the property, let's head back to James, who has one of the most beautiful red antelope.
I'm just reversing everybody. We had a herd of impala, but they've gone into the bushes there. But there's some more alarm calling behind us. So let's go and have a look-see if there isn't something well with teeth and claws and golden fur, perhaps, that they are terrified of. Sounds like just about over there, maybe about 150 to 200 meters. Just reversing the boat. Which Viam very cynically called the Titanic yesterday, of course, given our luck with vehicles. And Red, you say if I am in a boat, I should start talking like a pirate. I think it might be a bit early in the morning for that. But it is a good idea. I quite like it. Arr. Yeah, we're just going to stop here and have a listen. Watch out for tracks on the road. Right, keep your ears open, everyone. Can hear elephants calling.
Morning, Station Eddie, update.
Let's keep going up the road here. I can't hear them anymore, but it sounded like somewhere around here. I know there's a clearing just up ahead, and maybe we'll be able to spot something there. Must keep carefully looking as we go up on the termite mounds, down in the shade. If it's a leopard or something like that, well, they're going to not be easy to see, even if they're walking in the open. Very nice termite mound there. I'm of course being utterly sarcastic, that was a pile of gravel. I'm going to turn off again and have a listen. The boat is just drifting now. Feel that, Brian? Now this tree over here is a favourite spot for both Tingana and Shadow when they come wandering over this way.
Good morning, Station. I copy all the route.
Just trying to hear again. Sounds like they might be further in that direction, the Impala. Yeah, they are. They're further on to Arethusa and Simbambili. Anyway, we're going to persist, go up the road here, see what happens. Just listening to the radio as well. So you can see this is a major game path here. And this major game path is a typical kind of path on which animals will move, both predators and prey, obviously not together, because it's just easier for them to move on a path like this. And on the path at the moment, I can see many elephant tracks, and I can see hyena tracks, and probably from our hyenas that have moved their den onto Simbambili, and that's why we're not going to the den as much of late. Now, Simbambili is the property to the west of us, but we are not allowed to traverse there. Human property laws preclude that. We are able to go to Arethusa to the west of us, and that's just a little bit further south. Arr. I'm just going to keep up with the radio, everyone. So if you do see me fiddling with this thing, we're in contact with a whole lot of other game drives around the place, and they'll keep us posted as to any activity that's going on. Some hyena tracks, a very large hyena going up the road. I don't know what else those impalas may have been alarming at. Here's possibly the best example of a game path. Look over to the right here, and you can see this heads straight towards Sydney's Dam. Sydney's Dam, of course, one of the last waters, or will be one of the last watering holes to actually hold moisture as the dry season progresses. And this goes straight there. It looks like a highway. Hello, Anne, you're in Canada and you're wondering about migration patterns, and I think this is a really good question. I'm just going to not drive while we answer because I want to listen. Anne, you say, do any of the animals migrate during the winter? They don't. Did they used to? Yes, probably they did. We think that they used to go up into the mountains. So, for example, before the advent of people in this area, there are about sort of 4.5 million people living on the borders of the Kruger National Park. Most of them were kind of shoved into the area by the apartheid regime. And so before it was so populated and before the advent of the Kruger National Park, so let's say 150 years ago, 150 years ago, Animals like elephants especially would have moved into the mountains for the wintertime, so they would have done a migration off to the west and then come back down here for the summertime. It is wetter up there. There's forest, there's a lot more grassland up on the highlands, and so I think many animals would have made that migration to the west. Now, with that barrier of humanity, it's not possible. And also, with their provision of water, remember there are a lot of private landowners and lots of dams, artificial dams in the Kruger National Park, the necessity for animals to move for water has been removed largely. And so while they may want to move out to get hold of some fresh grazing and fresh forage, for water they just don't need to anymore, so they don't migrate anymore in this area. But yes, absolutely, an east-west migration. And what an amazing thing it must have been to, as an early visitor to this area, to come down in the wintertime and find elephants in the forests of the Drakensberg there, to find perhaps big herds of wildebeest streaming across the dust or creating huge dust clouds as they go into the foothills of the mountains and perhaps even onto the highlands. Just turn that down a bit. Now, we're going to turn south here. We've come pretty much as far north as we can. In fact, I'm going to suggest we go and check Sydney's dam as the only last water, and then we'll head south again. I suspect some elephants may be moving towards the water already. Some will drink in the evening, some in the morning, and some, well, twice a day. Those that are very thirsty. Debbie, what a lovely question from you in Vancouver. You say, just quickly, I'm just going to tell you where we are. We're at the gate of the Sabi Sands here, and that's why there's going to be a little bit of infrastructure here, but don't worry, it will disappear soon. You say, do I think that natural selection is being affected by human beings, and do I feel that our activities are perhaps facilitating the selection for more intelligent predators? No, I don't. And I'll tell you why. Sorry, this radio is going to drive me insane. I don't think that we are, you know, natural selection is exactly that. It's natural. It's selection that is natural.
Oopsie-daisy, and it seems as though that James's signal has disappeared. You're on the back of Rusty, and you can join me in trying to figure out the mystery that is the lion tracks all over the southern boundary of Gowrie, Maine. Up and down, up and down. Apparently, I've just bumped into Shanae, and she said that they were seen crossing north into Torchwood at some point early this morning. It just was that they were chasing a herd of buffalo, or following a herd of buffalo at least. I'm trying to find you a nice track so I can show you exactly what I mean. These tracks are fresh, so we must have, I think, maybe missed out on seeing them just by half an hour or so. I can sort of see what I mean. There's female tracks here as well. Let me try and show you. It's a bit tricky here because a lot of them have already been driven over. But we've got a few here where the male went to spray the tree. And in fact, I can smell him. Smell the scent of the male lion. I'll jump out and just show you exactly what it is that I'm looking at as soon as I've managed to untangle myself from scarf / earpiece. There we go. I think I might be able to get out now. All the way from Twin Dams to where we are now, which is sort of between Chitwa and Torchwood, the tracks go up and down all the way. There's fresh set going up this way, so going to the east. There's also this set going to the west. And this is definitely male lion, and it's actually fresh because I can smell where he's sprayed on this bush. And I'm just trying to see if there's any moisture left still. Very distinctive smell, lion urine. How's this, Gert? Is this, can you see this one? Perfect, thank you. So for those of you who are new to tracking or new to the live safaris. This is what a lion paw print looks like. This is the back part of his foot, the back pad. And these are his four, oh my word, it's very smelly down here. These are his four toes. And he's going that way. How do I know that it's a male versus a female? Well, just the sheer size of his track. I mean, if we look at, let's use this as an example. It's a nice clear one. The entire outline of the track is here. So if I trace it like this, that's the outline of his track. That's the size of my hand as a comparison. So basically, his paw print is the size of my hand. And off he went in that direction. But according to Shanae, he then came back and went up into Torchwood, or went north into Torchwood. So they've just been all over the show. And we've spoken about this before, about the fact that Gowrie Main serves as basically a highway for the Birmingham boys. It's part of the central part of their territory. Hornbills, sorry, not, I thought it was alarm calling zebra. It's a central part of their territory. And they use it regularly as a path from A to B, or in that case from Cheetah Plains towards Juma and Arethusa. And they also use it as a very important scent marking area to make sure everybody knows that this is their territory. Now those of you who are more familiar with tracking, you might have noticed that those tracks looked a bit degraded in a way. And there's two reasons for that. One is that that sand is very, very soft and fine, which means that whilst the track shows up clearly, it also disintegrates very quickly. Now, it was a bit windy last night, and that combined with the regular passage of vehicles up and down this road makes the tracks look less fresh than they usually would. Just about 200 meters south of where we are now, there is one of the biggest dams left in this area, so one of the dams with the most water, which means that a buffalo herd would spend a great deal of time moving through this area. We are about to come upon the Mulwanini, which is the river system that runs through Torchwood. And it might mean that our signal will dip, but let's go through nice and slowly and search and see if we can't spot Tundi before we just, oh, these lions, they're driving me crazy. Their tracks are just everywhere. Just want to check something quickly. So fresh and going straight towards the Chitwa Dam. Okay, onwards we go. See if we can't investigate further. While we go through the Mulwanini, and so that we don't lose you completely, James has signal once again, so let's go on the back of the boat.
So sorry about that, everybody. You went to check Sydney's dam. I'm not entirely surprised that we didn't have signal there, to be honest. We're using Wendy's kit, and we know Wendy wasn't great there. Anyway, here we are. We're coming south now, down the boundary between Arethusa, Simbambili, and Juma. And just checking, I think these are the impala that were shouting earlier on that I heard, going pff, pff, pff. Oh, I can hear hyenas going. Oh, and monkeys going crazy up ahead, going. Hold on, we're going to drive quite quickly. There's something going on here. On the road, there were our monkeys shouting. Okay. Now, monkeys will only shout if they see a predator. They won't shout just for the sake of it. Drive quite fast. Debbie, I will get back to your question about natural selection and intelligent predators. It's a little bit colder when we drive at this speed, isn't it, Brian? Right, we'll stop here, we're just in the next dip. I can't see any tracks, but this road is driven so much that it would be very easy for animals to walk up and down here and their tracks would be obliterated. Looking in the trees for monkeys. Right, let's listen here. They're still going. You hear them, Brian? Now they've stopped. No, there they go. They're still quite a long way ahead of us. Just wonder if they're not actually to the west. We're going to get up onto the crest here and then stop and have a good listen. I'm going to just take my earpiece out and open up my ears. There's an elephant looking very cross. It's behind us now, the monkeys. Can you hear where they are, Brian? I think they're on Impala Road, which isn't far from here. Let's go onto these power lines here and go and have a look. I just don't seem to be getting any closer to them. They're probably up there now. That's not ideal. What did I hit? Oh dear. I think it's a large stump. Ah. Hey, well, let's pretend that didn't happen, everybody. Please delete the last few minutes from your life. Elephants up ahead, monkeys shouting there, me not watching the road in the rising sun. But one elephant was standing here with his ears out, as if to indicate that he'd seen a predator, perhaps. There are some more elephants, which we will show to you. There are lots of them. I'm just going to get into a position where we can watch them cross the road. Jamie says I need to watch out for the icebergs. She's absolutely correct, of course. Let's stop here and have a listen. Are they still going, those monkeys? People, I think we should come back to these elephants. I think let's go and see if we can't find what those monkeys are shouting at. Sorry, chaps, don't get a fright as we go past. There we go, well done. It was a very large iceberg that we hit there. Here. Right, Jamie's got something interesting to look to show you. Go and have a look there, and I'll keep looking over here.
So while James rushes to follow the monkey alarm calls, we have some glorious buffalo in the morning sunlight, dust flying everywhere. And my suspicion is that these buffalo have had a hard night, judging by the lion tracks everywhere. Although they look pretty relaxed at this point. I wonder how big this herd actually is. It's so bright I can barely tell. But I can hear rustling all around me. I think we've got a relatively large... And I can hear them mooing away. So we've got a relatively large herd here. There's a young male. Still hasn't quite got that impressive set of horns that the Duggar boys or the older males do. But he's got a few years to go and he will do. There's a female, nice contrast there in terms of looking at what a female versus a male looks like. You can see how she's got hair all over the base of her horns, much thinner, much smaller horns. And just in case you're a bit confused about the bulge on her belly, that is where her umbilical cord would have been. And it just scarred a little bit. A lot of females have that bump. There's another male. Starting, unfortunately, as we're going to see more and more of, some of the buffalo starting to look as though they're struggling a bit to meet their nutritional requirements. Oh, how's this light? So beautiful. And hear them mooing away in the distance. Arrow-marked babblers fussing in the distance. That's the bird call that you can hear. You can see what I mean? Hip bones starting to show through. They're still okay, but times are getting tough for the buffalo. Not as bad as it was at the beginning of the year. You can see, if you watch them trying to feed, searching for as much food as possible, the options are relatively limited. And they're just filling the air. Even though they're not running, they're filling the air with dust. Chat and I are going to be sneezing our way through the rest of the morning. So many of them moving in through this area. This is probably, it's hard to guess, I would say 150 odd strong. And Shamsun, as on the subject of the drought and the water holes. So we've spoken before about the fact that the Kruger National Park has closed a great deal of water holes, especially in the sort of area directly to the east of where we traverse. And that's been pushing buffalo herds and elephant bulls alike into our area. You're wondering whether or not why they have decided to do that and whether or not it will be more detrimental in the long run. It's a difficult question and it comes down to an understanding of the way in which things work. So the more water holes you have, the more hoof action you get in an area. So we've spoken before about this, about the fact that artificial water holes bring animals into areas where they might not naturally have occurred in large numbers because there's access to water. That's one of the reasons why the northern Sabi sands no longer has as many sable as it used to. Mala Mala, of course, meaning sable, due to the huge populations that were there when that area was first set aside as a conservation area. But the more water holes are pumped, the more animals like big herds of buffalo and hippopotamus start moving in, and the more hoof action you get, and by hoof action I mean just this constant pounding of the earth, constant grazing in the area, that does do damage in places when there isn't sufficient rainfall. Now the northern Sabi sands continues to provide water for these animals because of course they have been for the last however many years, and it's very difficult to just stop that provision of water. for animals like these buffalo, but the Kruger National Park has decided that because of the numbers of animals that they get in an area, by providing artificial water, they're going to actually destroy the areas around those water holes, because the buffalo, the elephants, the hippopotamus, the animals that are so water dependent, they're actually going to do serious damage to the plant life and therefore to the soil layer, because they're basically going to overgraze. And then when the big rains come, and they will come whenever it may be, whether it's this year or next year, when the big rains come and they dump sort of a quarter of the average rainfall in one night, the top layer of soil washes away and the area is forced into a long recovery period where the soil has to form again, the plants have to grow again, the grasses have to secure themselves all over, starting from scratch essentially. And that, bear in mind that these animals have got 4 million hectares of unfenced area which they can walk. So they will be able to travel to where there is water. And there is water still. A lot of the Kruger National Park's rivers do still have water, are still flowing. Oh, we are surrounded by probably, now that I'm looking at it, probably 200 buffalo. This is awesome. There's just buffalo everywhere. You can hear them rustling off to the right, rustling off to the left. And there we have the oxpeckers having an absolute field day. Look at this red-billed oxpecker hopping around in tick haven. Contact calling to the rest of its family. Hop, hop, hop. Oh. Upsetting the apple cart. Look at this female. She's got a hat on. She's got a headpiece, a leaf that has got stuck on the back of her horns. The latest thing in buffalo fashion. Shame. Hard life. We're watching each and every individual buffalo here searching about for grass that they can eat. Now, times that by 200, you get an idea as to the impact that a buffalo herd of this size will have on an area. Slowly, slowly making their way west. Wonder where the lions are that were meant to have been following this buffalo herd. Perhaps they shall make an appearance. Big old bull. See the scratches from where he's walked through trees? He's almost got a symbol on his shoulder. And the passage of a buffalo herd of this size is not a quiet entity. The air is filled with the sound of rustling and mooing and dust absolutely everywhere. And it smells a little bit like a dairy farm. For those of you who were wondering a little bit about the sensory impact that it has. Very heavy cow-like scent. What interesting cow it is on the right there. She looks sort of old and yet young at the same time. She's quite small, but her horns are quite corroded. Interesting girl. So while we watched the buffalo searching for any edible grass, Matthew was wondering, would a buffalo ever eat leaves if there's a scarcity of grass? The answer is yes, they do relatively regularly supplement their diet with a leaf every now and again. Their particular favorite in terms of trees, I've noticed, seems to be the apple leaf tree. They will often go and nibble on apple leaf. Occasionally, they might go for something like a silver cluster leaf or maybe a bush willow, but the apple leaf preference seems to prevail. Most of them have moved off. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try and turn around, first of all so that I can move out of Ephraim's way, but also so that we can have a look at them as they slowly retreat and maybe get a better idea as to the numbers. Morning, guys. How's it, Ephraim? Good, thanks. Yeah, there's Nkonzo up, down, backwards, forwards, everywhere. Pardon? Yeah, I think so. Are there any updates from that side? I'll tell you if I find anything. Sure, bye-bye. Ephraim just wondering if I'm going to go and check cheetah plains, which of course is the plan. Just turn around, see what this view looks like from the top of this ridge. Hopefully it's quite spectacular. Oh. Just a sort of a long distance view of Ephraim and his guests and a multitude of buffalo slowly making their way to the west. They're spread out on the northern and the southern side of the road. They don't look nervous, to be honest. It doesn't look as though they've been chased by lions all of last night. But then I suppose when you're a buffalo, you sort of accept that as your due. They relax relatively quickly. That being said, we've often seen buffalo the day after they've been chased by lions throughout the evening, and they don't tend to look quite so relaxed. But perhaps there was a small offshoot from this herd that suffered the full brunt of hunting lions. And Sandy, you were wondering why buffalo travel in such large herds, since surely the stragglers don't get much to eat. Really good question, actually. The typical, stereotypical answer to that is safety in numbers, particularly for the young calves that are incredibly vulnerable. And I mean, we get buffalo herds here up to 1,000 strong. The last time Brent and myself were in the Kruger National Park, we saw a buffalo herd that stretched easily for a kilometre as we travelled along the road. There must have been 1,000, 1,500 buffalo. I mean, you see that little calf wandering at the back there. They are exceptionally vulnerable, and I guess that the trade-off comes from safety in numbers versus the opportunity to feed. I know that that's not an entirely satisfactory answer. You raise a very good point, because surely splitting off into 50 or maybe 20 buffalo, you still get the protection, although not quite to the same extent, and then access to food. An elephant herd's much smaller than a buffalo herd. The instinct, the herding instinct is there. It's a good question, and it's one that I don't have a complete answer for. I think these large herds, it really is just more about safety than anything else. Although a buffalo herd as an entity is not the smartest thing in the world. They can be, some upset buffalo there. They can be very panicky. And as soon as one panics, the rest disappear. Now that I'm full of dust and hay fever, our buffalo herd is moving off. James, Richard, you were wondering how a buffalo herd compares to the smell of an elephant herd. Buffalo herd really does smell like cows. It smells like a farmyard almost. It smells like a collection of cows all together. An elephant herd is a very different, it's much more planty, if that's even a word. It's a scent of almost decaying plant material, but a really nice smell. And to me, I prefer the smell of an elephant herd to a buffalo herd. Maybe that's just the association that I have with the animal. But it's interesting how different the different animals smell, and it's largely dependent on their dung, of course. And the elephant's digestive system, because it's much less efficient than the buffalo, the plant material smell comes through a lot stronger than the cow smell that comes from the buffalo. My favorite smell in the bush is the smell of black rhino dung, which I haven't smelt here at all, but it is absolutely one of the best smelling things, and I don't know why, because their diet's very similar to that of an elephant. There's just something about the particular tree species that they target that I found is a stunning smell. And speaking of elephants, while our buffalo disappear, it seems as though James has found some more for you to look at.
Hello everybody, there's an elephant just in here. We're still sitting around here trying to see if we can't figure out what those monkeys are alarming at. I thought I saw a flash of a white tail going through the bush, so I head off road to have a look, and it turned out to be nothing. So maybe it was just my psychology. Anyway, the monkeys are still shouting, and apparently they were shouting around here yesterday as well. Can't see the elephants anymore, I'm afraid. Let's just continue forward and we'll do a little turn around, basically exactly the same route that we went. But they're looking straight into this area. There are some kudu, which don't look particularly terrified by life. Do they, Brian?
No.
Very nice picture of them in the early morning sun. But you can still hear the monkeys shouting. The kudu are walking towards where they're shouting, and they're on the boundary. We might actually be able to show them to you. They're on the boundary, and they're looking straight this way. So what they're looking at, I don't know. Herbert is going to come across here and see if he can't find them. By them, I mean whatever it is making those monkeys so very cross. But I'll try and show you where they are. Kudu chilled to the max. Don't even see the monkeys anymore. I'm just hoping a predator is going to pop out into the open here, which of course could well happen. There you can see the monkeys. I'll just quickly turn so you can see them. You will just be able to make out a greyish patch in a green tree there. Can you see what I'm looking at, Brian? That's the monkeys. And they're shouting sort of into the thickets of this area. Now, we did drive right underneath them. I mean, this is a really good opportunity for us to find the predator, but again, you can see the kudu. They are very relaxed. I haven't seen any tracks, except for hyena tracks, but, you know, monkeys wouldn't alarm call it hyenas. It would only be lions or leopards. And they are still cross. I think whatever it is actually quite close to them. Let me move back a bit. We'll just scan underneath the bushes here, but it might be a good idea for me to go in there on foot and see if we can't find something that way. We'll see some more impala. They look chilled to the max as well. Ooh, hyena, just behind us, right here. Now, this is going to be interesting. Where's this hyena going? Because hyenas will follow alarm calls. They know. He's just spotted an impala. Going straight towards the monkeys. We're just going to watch him go. Not allowed to follow him off-road. Let's just watch that hyena very carefully. We need to sneak forward, Brian, and get a slightly better view. Now, impala alarm calling, but they will alarm call at the hyena. Hyenas will be doing exactly what we're doing. They'll be watching those monkeys, hearing them alarm calling, think, something may have been killed around here. Let me see if I can't pilfer it. And of course, they are also blessed with much sharper noses than ours. And just impala running in the background there as the hyena came wandering through. And those monkeys still alarm calling frantically. Let's have a look with the binos, see where they're looking. Oh, they're still sort of looking down this way into the thickets over here. So Jamie is almost at Cheetah Plains at the moment. And when she gets there and signal is back, I will wander off in here on foot and just have a quick look through here and see if I can't find a spotted cat or perhaps a tawny one. But at the moment, I can't see anything. Now, while we're sitting here waiting, let's just, it's worth just sitting here for a couple of minutes. Let's just chat about that natural selection question about predators being selected for more intelligence and our effects on that. I'm not really sure that I understand the context of the question, but, natural selection is such that whatever strategy works best is going to be the most successful, as the woodpecker in this tree. And so I'm not sure what selection pressure would be on predators to become more intelligent in the way that we consider ourselves intelligent. Lions are brilliantly intelligent for what they do. They're never going to do advanced calculus, but they don't need to. It doesn't help them to do advanced calculus. It doesn't help them to be able to speak in the human tongue. It doesn't help them to be able to do that at all. Their strategy for how they are is perfectly suited to life as it is now. Now, I mean, the thing that acts on natural selection wouldn't act on natural selection except were we to change the environment. It's the environment that will create an action where natural selection or the pressures for natural selection to operate on. So, you know, were the environment to change to the extent that, say, this is a totally random example, that, say, impala were able to smell lions let's say impala were able to detect lions in some way that made it impossible for lions in their current strategy to hunt them. And if by being able to talk to each other, lions were more successful at hunting impala, then they would become more intelligent in a human way. Then they would, they would evolve in such a way that allowed them to hunt more successfully. But at the moment, no, I don't think that human activity around the world is having a noticeable effect on the natural selection for the intelligence of predators. I hope that kind of answers your question. If it doesn't, please feel free to ask again. I'm going to have one more look with my binos, and then we're going to go a little bit forward and see if there isn't something wandering through the clearings, and then I'll go off on foot. Yeah, they're still sitting there. And Shamsung, you say, could these baboons be arguing amongst themselves? Shamsung, these are not baboons. They are monkeys. Baboons are different kind of primate, and they know they can't be arguing amongst themselves. They do argue amongst themselves, but this is not the sound they make. This is the sound of alarm. They've seen a predator. That's exactly the sound they make when they see a predator. There's the woodpecker. It's got a little nest there. Look at that. That's fantastic. Digging out a little hole. That perfect red colour. Looks like a cardinal woodpecker. It is a male cardinal woodpecker. Oh, those monkeys are still shouting. There's definitely something in there. That's a lovely sighting of it. Really, really nice sighting of a woodpecker. All right, I'm going to hand you back to Jamie now. She's on Cheetah Plains. Let's see what she can find there. I'm going to wander through here on foot, and I'll catch up with you in a few minutes.
While James goes walkabout, I have quite exciting news, although unfortunately they have been driven over. But there's tracks for a female leopard and her cub, from what I can tell, going straight along this road. Let's keep our fingers crossed, and if we try and just, let me have a look at something quickly. Ooh, hoist Rusty off the road. Okay, her tracks are here. I'm just gonna hop off quickly to see if I can't spot where her, I think I saw cub tracks. But before I get myself overly excited, let's have a look and see. And just by the way, just to make you all jealous, you know, it's not meant to be mean-spirited way, but for Gert, it's very exciting because we just saw the first honey badgers that Gert has seen since he started here. Unfortunately, in the worst possible place. We had absolutely no signal, so we couldn't show them to you. And you know what honey badgers are like, they run. It's just trees rustling. Just double checking, I'm not about to walk straight into her. I know it's really difficult for you to see, so I'm gonna point them out to you. Her tracks are here. Ooh, I say her tracks. I know that Inkanyeni is quite big, but this might actually be a male that's walking along this road before I get too excited. So the track is here. This is the back pad here with its little toes. And there's nothing neater than a leopard track. This is its left foot and there's its back left foot. The front foot is always larger and rounder than the back. And there we have the back track, slightly longer and slightly more narrow. And the way that you can tell if it's the left foot or the right foot, you look at your own hand. Your middle finger is the longest, and the same applies to the toes of a leopard or a lion or a hyena. The left, the middle one always sticks out the most. So this is the middle toe here. Here's the sort of the equivalent of our index finger, the fourth finger, and the pinky. So that is the middle finger equivalent for a leopard. It's going this way. And it's fresh. It's fresh enough that it's time for us to stop delaying and start following. Now the wind is howling here on Cheetah Plains, which tells me a couple of things. One, these tracks could well be fresher than they look, because the wind will blow sand over them and start to obscure their outline. And two, the cold front is arriving earlier than I expected it to. Okay, let's do this quite carefully. We found ourselves all alone on Cheetah Plains. Oh, it's up to us to find this leopard. Still driven over. It does make life a bit more tricky. And we'll just keep checking the side. Gert, you've got to spot us the leopard. It's your time to shine. Oh, they're so beautifully fresh. They're on the side of the road now. Okay, we're coming up to a junction. He's walking on the right-hand side of the road. Usually, that means that it's going to cut to the right, usually, because an animal doesn't like to waste its energy taking the long way around. However, you cannot make that assumption. You have to double check, which is what we're going to do at this junction here. And he's gone down this road. And even with the windy morning, the outline of the tracks in the soft sand is so fresh, so crisp and clear, that this leopard could well be just around the next corner. Whenever this is, might just be me, but whenever I find fresh leopard tracks like this, my heart rate always goes up a little bit in excitement. There we go. These are small tracks now. Is this a male and a female? This is not the same set of tracks we had earlier. Unless Inkanyeni's feet are bigger than I expect, because those could well be cub tracks. Oh, I'm so excited. Come on, Chad, we've got to do this. It'll be the first time I've seen Inkanyeni. And she's just gone in here. Carol and many other viewers are confused by poor Chad's name, our cameraman's name. His name is, say it with me, Chad. Chad, your name is Chad, right? Chad.
G-E-R-T.
G-E-R-T. Chad. Oh, before I get too distracted by Chad's name, I better make sure I'm looking for this leopard. Chad. Chad. Okay, so it's a bit of a difficult one for those of you who are English speaking. Those of you who are Dutch or of Germanic descent, it's a little bit easier for you to say. It's that ch sound. So it's not gert. We don't say it gert. It's gert. And you have to roll your R slightly to get it absolutely right. Gert. So that is Gert's name. My apologies for those of you. I probably should have made it a little bit clearer. But of course, I sort of sometimes forget, because it's so instinctive to us as South Africans, that I forgot to explain it fully to you. And the bad news is that our leopard's just gone off the road, and I think she's gone off to the right. He, she, it. I'm so a bit confused at this point. The tracks are big enough to be either a big female's or a young... Oh no, here we go. Here we go, here we go, here we go. They're still here. Oh. Okay, just bear with me 1 second. I just want to get out for one moment. I just want to make sure that we're following these leopard tracks properly. Coming through here. Oh, these windy days, it's not that much fun to go tracking on windy days like this. It's so easy to accidentally surprise an animal, which is the last thing you want to do. Just checking ever so carefully where this leopard is going. She's going this way. Okay. Just want to make sure we don't go off in the wrong direction. I'm so excited. Make sure I shut the door properly so that I don't fall out of it, which has nearly happened a few times. All right, Gert, let's go find her. I'm a bit bemused here, because these tracks that we're tracking, and I'll pull over so that you can have a look where I drew that line, but I'm not going to linger. They're exactly where I drew the line with my foot. Much smaller than the ones we were looking at earlier. Now, usually I'd get out and show you with a bit of perspective, but I'm not going to, because I want to keep moving, because these tracks are going south. South is Fine. We've got another kilometer to the border, but I'm just really hoping we catch her in case she does decide to go to Mala Mala. Still here. Oh, this is a tricky spot to spot leopards. It's very dense. Oh, this is so fresh. She's still on the right-hand side of the road. Another junction. Okay. Right, which way do we think she's going to go? Here's how you figure it out, or at least attempt to, although leopards it's a bit more tricky than it is with lions. The whole time we've been tracking her, she's been walking in a general southeasterly direction. These two roads split, one goes to the west, one goes southeast. So my instinct is that she's gone this way, but I want to try and check that it's borne out by where her tracks go. And unfortunately, it looks as though she might have moved off the road for this particular part of the journey. It's a bit more tricky than that though, because she was also walking again, as I said earlier, on the right-hand side of the road, which very often dictates which way an animal moves when it does move off. So let's check here quickly. Make sure that she hasn't come along here. Scan the ground. Don't think so. No, sorry, yes she has. She just, oh, you sneaky, sneaky leopard. She's popped out right where I'm parked. So she went off the road, maybe to have a sniff around. If it's with her cubs, then perhaps that's why they did it. And she's continuing on. If we look in the patch of sun in the middle of the road, you will be able to see her tracks there. There we go. Perfect. Thank you, Gert. There. Those are her tracks there. The fresh pug marks of a wandering leopard. And so on we go, because look now at the direction she's heading in. Into the block. See if she hasn't popped out further along the road. Leopards are a tricky thing to track, because lions usually pick a direction and they kind of just go with it, unless they get distracted by something to hunt. Leopards, on the other hand, especially Karula. Tracking Karula is like a Mensa test all of its own. Okay, she has gone off in here. Let's check all of the termite mounds. If I were a leopard, no, she's still here. She is still here. Okay, good. If I were a leopard in this chilly morning, she might be going to a kill. Or she might be looking for a nice spot on a termite mound to sun herself. And the angle of the sun is just wrong that I can't look far enough ahead to drive fast with confidence that I'm not going to miss where her track's gone off. I'm so determined to find Inkanyeni. It'll be the first time I've seen her. The track's still here. Still on the road and still beautifully fresh. This is where I do wish I was taller, so that I wouldn't have to keep pulling off the road. She's gone off. Okay, I do need to concentrate on searching for this leopard for you, particularly in this area. It's very thick, she could be hiding anywhere. So while we search for her, let's go back to James and find out how his tracking went.
Now I've done a turn through, I walked through that whole block where the monkeys were looking and I could find nothing. Then the impala started alarm calling around here. There they are over there. Then they stopped alarm calling, naturally, as we got here. And there are elephants that are rumbling in there, which would indicate that something must have walked across this road that's called is causing them to be upset. I can't see anything. I can't see any tracks. But there are a whole lot of impala, and they look very cross. So those monkeys could have been shouting at a predator that was lying down, and then it got up and it walked this way. I don't know, it's all very frustrating, I have to say. Where are they looking? Just go a little bit forward. Well, they're all looking straight this way. And the elephants were just inside there, also getting a little upset. But you'd expect that there would be some tracks of something or other going across the road. And a very strange wind has come up. Feels like there's a front sort of just hit us, and I heard it coming from a long way off. It's very interesting. You just started to hear the trees rustling, and then suddenly the wind hit us. But I don't know. Good morning, Caleb. You're interested in whether you could, first of all, tame one of these, and you say they're gazelles. They're not gazelles, they're a different sort of tribe of the same family. So they're called antelope, which is a very, sort of very similar to a gazelle, but not the same. And you couldn't tame one of them, I don't think, from as an adult, but if you raised one as a lamb, I do know that various people have managed to sort of have them as not quite pets, but certainly, you know, they'll tame sufficiently to live in your garden.
Very well, thanks. And you said? Well,
there's a big slump in Yari at my time, very big.
Okay, copy that. Thank you very much.
All right, I think we should start up. We'll go a little bit forward, turn around, come back down this road and see if we can't find any more tracks. If not, well, you know, we'll just go and see what else we can see. Very nice prospects for Jamie. I'll be very jealous if she sees Nkanyeni's cubs. She does definitely deserve to see Nkanyeni. The rest of us have managed to be lucky enough to see her. In my case, nothing to do with skills. She just happened to be draped over a tree when I came past one day. It was very kind of her to be draped over a tree. And Carla, a very good observation from you. You say, is it typical that a hyena like the one we saw would go off solo like that on its own? Well, that's what solo means, I guess, and try and forage. Yes, it is entirely typical. It's entirely in keeping with their behavior. And then, as you say, if they find something, they'll make a big noise and attract their mates. In about 700 minds as to what to do here. Anyway, let's just go down here, see if there are any tracks crossing the road. Maybe a leopard will just wander out onto the road in front of us, which would be very nice indeed. Herbert says he had monkeys alarm calling in this area earlier yesterday. Anyway, we might be lucky. We might not. The last time Brian and I found a leopard from monkey alarm calls, it was about, what, 300 meters from them? 300 or 400 meters, that's a quarter of a mile they were shouting. So, I mean, it, in theory, could be anywhere in here. whatever it is. Let's just drive slowly down here and we'll see if any of those elephants pop out as well. I got all warm on my walk and now I'm getting chilly again, Brian. It's not nice. Let's just have a little listen here, which is a translation for I need to put my jacket back on. Let's see if we can hear anything here. I don't hear anything further, do you, Brian? I just heard a black-headed oriole going. Lovely call. But otherwise, all is quiet again. I mean, just check up the road. There's a bump on the road. I think it's a piece of vegetation. It is indeed. And you know, all around, I can hear elephants. You won't be able to hear them because they're making a very low rumbling. I think we'll carry on down the road here and we'll come back up the other way. And see what else we can see. Brian, you're putting on gloves. Yeah, this front is hitting us. Alas and alack. Lucky we're in a boat though, Brian, so if it rains, we'll be fine. Yes. No. Let's just carry on down the road here. What we'll do is we'll go back along where we saw those other elephants and come back north. Maybe something will pop out. Maybe it won't. But there will be something interesting to look at on the way. Of that I have no doubt. We've been in one area for quite some time now, of course. Can just gently drift down the road here, Brian. There we are. There's nothing in the middle of the road there, is it? It's elephant dung, I think. Yeah, it's just dung. Now, just a quick tree to show you. This tree here, which many of you will know, I'm sure, is called an ebony or a jackalberry. And what's interesting about it is that it's what we call semi-deciduous, which means that it's not going to lose all of its leaves at the same time in winter as a traditional deciduous tree does. But if you look at it to the left-hand side, just there, Brian, it's kind of down a bit, there, that bit there, it's losing its leaves there. And so it will lose its leaves kind of intermittently throughout the year and then gain them again so that it's never completely without leaves. And that is a very effective strategy because it means that you're never without a constant food supply. And out here, unlike in most parts of the Northern Hemisphere, well, you know, many parts of the Northern Hemisphere where it gets so cold that it's ineffective for trees to be active during the winter time. You know, here it doesn't really ever get cold enough for a tree to have to go dormant because of the temperature. So it's quite a successful strategy, that. Keep going down here. And go a little bit faster. Let's see if we aren't very lucky. And as I've said a few times of late, I think that our luck finding animals has as much to do with luck as it does to do with tracking. It always feels great when you find the tracks of something and then you find whatever that is. But basically, I find that for tracks, they put me in the right area. But there's so much luck involved. And here is all the elephant activity from this morning. You can see there on the road. There we go, and that's from the elephants we saw early this morning. And Brian, there's a hornbill there. He might be unsighted. You got him. Now, Corey, a very nice question from you. Can you judge the speed that an animal is walking from its tracks? You can, to a certain extent. The most obvious example is something like a lion. And a lion, when it is... You can tell the difference between front and back foot. And there's something in here as well, Brian. I don't know what it is. I can just hear rustling. I think it's a little Franklin. It is. Corey, with a lion, when they're walking, the back foot does not reach over the top of the front foot. So when you can see exactly where they put their front feet and then their back foot comes down behind the front foot. If they're jogging or walking quickly, the front foot, at least the back foot, eventually lands on top of the front foot. And then if they're running, the back foot will go over the track of the front foot. So that's a really easy way of telling with a lion. There's a crested Franklin in there, everybody. He thinks we can't see him, you see. But with something, there we go, out he comes. Lovely. But Corey, with something like an antelope or what else? In any of the herbivores, basically, and the predators, you can tell whether they're running or walking by the amount of scuff there is. So a running antelope, or buffalo especially, will scuff up the sand more. And you can tell from that scuff whether it was strolling gently past or whether it was running away from something. I'll try and show you the difference if I find any obvious differences. That's a really nice shot of the crested Franklin, just lurking under what we call a white berry bush, looking for seeds and insects and maybe, yeah, I guess there could be some seeds from that white berry bush under there. Perfectly, perfectly coloured, aren't they? Beautiful little red legs and the white flecking on the back, which gives it that sort of dappled appearance, which makes it very difficult to spot under a white berry bush like this. See how the eye stripe almost matches perfectly the color of the termite mound behind. Okay, let's continue on our way. We're going to go to the power line road, which is just up ahead here, back along towards where those elephants were, and then back up to the north. It's a very nice Franklin sighting. Best place to turn here. Right, let's turn up this way. Just an update on Karula. As far as I'm aware, she is knocking about. She's knocking about little Gauri on an adult impala kill with her youngsters, so the chances of her wandering up this way, I'm afraid at the moment, are fairly small, but she'll finish that impala eventually and come up this away. There are a lot of kudu over there. Of course, as I go forward, they become entirely hidden by vegetation. Let me go a little, there we can see them. Kudu, the famous spiral-horned antelope, of course. Those ones having, well, there's a male. He's got spiraled horns. They'll all be pregnant, those ladies. And they'll give birth somewhere around the rainy season, which in theory should be in November, but could be any time from September. Now you can see how the wind has come up. You notice when we started there was no breeze like that. In typical herbivore style, or browsing style, they're able to eat. That they're eating a Sisyphus there, or a buffalo thorn tree, and they're able to eat the most tremendous thorns, cope with things that would tear your and my hands to pieces, let alone our tongues. Very nice, Brian. Kudu cows. Small groups they occur in, not very large. And I think I saw Herbert coming up into the area. Oh, there's another big elephant. Marvellous. That is an enormous tusker. Gee whiz. Wow, Brian. He's amazing. He might be worth going around the other way to go and have a look at, everyone. That, you know what? Oh, there he turns. There he turns. He has got giant tusks. That's the biggest tusker I've seen here by a country mile. Wow. Sorry, Rebecca, you'll have to go again with that last message. And apparently, Rebecca's just saying that she thinks this elephant was seen with Brent while I was on leave. Look at those incredible tusks. Now, they will never stop growing, those tusks, everyone. Let's just reverse back. He's walking towards a clearing now. We'll get a nice view of him. Hello, Karen. You're in Tanzania. How wonderful to hear from you. I hope it's a marvelous day wherever you are in Tanzania. You say, what is going to happen to his tusks after he dies? Will someone collect them? Depends whether they know where he dies. You know, when these elephants die, they're often in down by rivers where it's difficult to, where they're hiding away, basically, when they die. They're starved to death. Sometimes their tusks just get lost. And so if he's found when he's dead, then absolutely the tusks will be collected and put in a stockpile, which will hopefully be burned. He is just magnificent. So we saw that elephant bull this morning. He was about 10 feet tall, probably weighed about 5.5 tons. This guy is at least 10 years older, I would say. His tusks are much bigger. That's a genetic thing, though. I mean, the tusks of that other fellow are never going to be this big, I don't think. Let me just back up a little bit more. And I reckon this guy is probably another half ton heavier. He's going straight towards those kudu. That's interesting. Sandy, you say that you saw an elephant with no tusks at the dam cam just now, and you want to know how that is or why that is. It's just genetic, Sandy, in the same way that some people are big and some people are small. You know, those big tusks don't necessarily advantage that elephant. And so an elephant is perfectly capable of surviving without tusks. but it does help them with defense, and it does help them when they are in the middle of fighting with each other. Go ahead, Brent. He is absolutely fantastic. Let's get him going across the main road. I'm just going to let him come through that bush there, everybody. He's definitely watching us quite carefully. And it's amazing, you know, and this is completely psychological, but it's seeing an elephant with tusks like that is much more intimidating than seeing the same size elephant with smaller tusks. And that is no, I mean, there's no reason that should be the case. Well, he is in must. He's definitely in must. You can see him streaming between his back legs. He is an absolute giant. There, you can smell it now. Sweet, leathery smell of elephant must.
James.
Go ahead. Copy, thanks. I'm not sure how long we're going to sit around here for. But let's just give him a chance to come and say hi. He doesn't look angry with us at all. Does he, Brian? Not crossy. Chris, you ask a very valid question now, of course. If an elephant was to charge us, what should we do? It depends entirely on how close it is and whether the charge is genuine, and it's really a difficult question to answer. But if this elephant, for example, was to charge, it's highly unlikely an elephant is ever just going to turn and charge. They're far more likely to give you a warning. If you don't heed that warning, then they might get irritated enough to come and chase you. But that certainly isn't the case with this elephant. Well, not yet. So, I mean, what he would do if he got crossed would be to shake his head towards us. But I'll get onto that now, Chris. Let's just get a last view of him. What an incredible, incredible animal. Get a view of him coming through here now. I think he's going to fetch up at Sydney's Dam in a little while. That's the sort of direction that he's heading. And I don't know if you can see there, but you can see maybe the urine dripping. And he loses a tremendous amount of water every day from that when he's in must. And it will mean that he has to go and have a drink fairly soon. Fantastic, fantastic fellow. So, Chris, if an elephant charges you, yeah, I mean, it's so difficult to answer. If it's a serious charge, you've got to get away. You know, you can try and stand your ground if you like, but an elephant, if it's very seriously going to charge you, well, not much is going to turn it. So your only recourse, basically, is to try and move out the way. The big thing, though, with an elephant is that they will warn you. Nine times out of ten, they will let you know that they're not comfortable with you, that they're irritated and they don't want you around. If you fail, and then you just move away. If you fail to heed those warnings, well, then you can obviously get yourself into quite a lot of trouble. But I think you'll find that, you know, nine times out of ten you will be warned. Now, what can happen with a bull like that? He's in must, so he could be irritated, and so he could just start coming towards you like he did a little bit on the road there. It's entirely possible that he could come sort of wandering along towards where you are, and then you get into a position there. Gee whiskers, look at the horns on this kudu. You see how widely spaced they are? He's very far away, so it won't be a great picture, but you'll get an idea. So, Chris, if he was to walk towards you, you get into a position where you have to decide, is it a good idea to move away and risk disturbing him by starting the engine? Or should you just leave it and just sort of tolerate his presence very close to you? Now, I'm from the school of thought that says, if the animal is close enough to you that it makes you feel uncomfortable and therefore him uncomfortable, just increase the space. So I don't, you know, people say, no, well, you've got to stand down at charge. You've got to stand down when an elephant, you know, you've got to stand up to it and show it who's boss. Yes, thank you, Rebecca. And it's... apparently that kudu is called Zeus. I'm not sure if it's the same one. Many of them, of course, have got wide horns like that. So, Chris, I hope I answered your question for you there. I'm from the school of thought that says if an elephant is uncomfortable with you, just get out of the way. I think very much there is a culture amongst some guides where there is this kind of macho culture where we think that we're the big bosses of the wild, and therefore, you know, an elephant should move out of our way. And I don't subscribe to that simply because an elephant is very large and capable of doing some fairly severe damage. Magnificent, could do that. Okay, let's carry on along the way here. And Justin, you're wondering if there's ever been an incident in the bush where I've been genuinely scared. Yes, quite a few actually. But I mean, you're going to have incidents where you make a mistake and an elephant will charge, or you might get charged by a leopard or a lion. Normally, because you've cornered the animal by mistake. So I had my very first week of guiding, I was charged by a leopard. And that was simply because I was tracking her with two trackers. The trackers had split up and she felt cornered. So she charged in order to say to us, just get out of the way and leave me alone. Which of course we did thereafter. And I was genuinely afraid then. Elephants and buffalo specifically are the ones you really got to watch out for on foot. Buffalo, mainly because they can sleep fairly soundly behind a bush, and if you give them a fright, then they can get very upset with you. If they know you're there, they're normally absolutely fine if you're moving away from them. Elephants are, I mean, I hate to use the term unpredictable, because I think animals are, to a greater or lesser extent, pretty predictable, unlike human beings. But elephants can be moody. And they can be upset, like that bull in must. If he was to find you on foot, he may well sort of start to follow you, and that can be genuinely terrifying. All right, let's head across to Jamie. Let's get an update on her tracking. I do hope she finds those cats.
Oh, we're talking a little bit about tracking, and I know that you were discussing with James about being genuinely scared in the bush. I just want to sort of try and explain something. Have a look at the vegetation of this area, and I'm going to be quiet so that you can listen to the sound of the wind blowing through, and just look as we do a sort of a scan of the place where her tracks have disappeared. You'll get an idea of just what a challenge is facing us. Red-crested corhan. Listen to the sound of the wind. This is what we call somewhat affectionately, only ever so slightly joking. This is what we called getting scribbled weather. And what that means is that you can't hear and you can't see. The wind's howling. The animals can't hear you. They can't smell you. And you have an enormous chance in this kind of weather of bumping into something like a buffalo or an elephant. And you can see how little visibility there really is in this particular spot. And this is where her tracks have actually disappeared. I had this brief moment of suspicion that she might be hiding in the old reservoir that is off to our left. Now, I didn't really want to go and stick my head in there and be faced with an angry leopard. And they do enjoy this kind of spot. So I just chucked a log into the middle of it. It's just a small stick into the middle to see if there was anything there. There isn't, but that's exactly where her tracks have headed. Now, if you combine the fact that this is getting scribbled weather, and it's very descriptive that, it describes quite comfortably what might occur, and combine that with the fact that this is a getting scribbled area, vegetation-wise, you understand that I've been for some short walks, but they have been relatively short. Her tracks are still so fresh, though, and they're on this road. We've tracked her now for close to a kilometer that she's been wandering on these roads. So let's go and investigate. Three in the Row Pan is just up a little bit to the north of us. There's some angry fork-tailed drongos now alarm calling. I'm going to double check because this is exactly where her tracks go off. But she's kept me guessing. It's just one set of tracks, one female. So while I figure out what's upset these drongos as much as they have been, let's go back to James, who's got some mongoose.
Isn't that wonderful? Look at that, from that very, very large elephant bull down to these tiny little dwarf mongoose. And they're huddling there because in the same way that kids on a playground might huddle, I suppose, cold. And they just want a little bit of sun before they go out foraging to see what there is for breakfast. All huddled close together because the wind that has come up is a chilly one. And they don't like to be cold, these little mongoose. See their eyes shining in the sun. Now, I've been through this before, but I always think it's quite interesting. We've just seen that big elephant bull, and you know, he weighs about 6 tons, 6,000 kilograms, and one of these dwarf mongoose probably weighs about 600 grams, so that's 100 times less than a... No, it's much less, it's much more than that. Hang on. Let me just work this out. 0.6 times 1, 2, 3, 4, it's 10,000 times less than an elephant. 10,000 of those little mongoose will go into that big elephant bull. And there's a reason that they need to huddle in a chilly wind like this, and that elephant does not. That elephant doesn't get cold. Not in any way the same as these mongoose do, and that's because he is bigger, and that means that because of his surface area, he cools down much more slowly, and he heats up much more slowly than an animal like this. So these little mongoose will lose heat very fast when it's cold, and they'll gain heat very fast when it's too hot, and so they're ability to balance temperature must be mitigated by this kind of social huddling behavior, by the ability to live. That's probably to a large extent why they live in termite mounds, because their temperature inside a termite mound is largely regulated. It's very cleverly designed by the original builders, the termites. And so the temperature inside is regulated. It never gets too cold, never gets too hot. And that's why you'll find, you know, dwarf mongoose and many other small animals living either underground or in termite mounds. So if you're little, yes, there's a greater, probably sweeter things to eat. You can eat little insects and you can go and find a scorpion or an egg or make do with that. But there are disadvantages. There are pros and cons to just about every single strategy that the animals have out here. And the con of being little is that your energy balance is not very easy to maintain. And I always like this term. It's called the mass-specific metabolic rate. So if you really are feeling very awake, I'll explain what that is. What it means is that for every gram of mongoose, far more energy is used than for every gram or ounce of elephant. So 1 ounce of mongoose uses much more energy than 1 ounce of elephant. And that's because of that surface area to volume ratio. And so the surface area to volume ratio of a mongoose is that much higher than that of an elephant. And that's why you find that a mongoose loses so much more heat and therefore must eat much more and therefore has a much higher metabolic rate than something like an elephant. You can completely discount that if you found it boring. Physiology is not for everybody. In the same way that death metal isn't for everybody, right, Brian?
Exactly.
Yes.
Melodic death metal.
Melodic death metal. I wonder if these mongoose like melodic death metal, Brian.
Yes, they do.
You
obviously
think they do?
Obviously.
I'm not so sure about that. Although I can see them, listening to melodic death metal. But maybe on a Saturday they like a Mozart piano concerto.
Most likely.
That elephant definitely likes Mozart. I've got no doubt about that. He's definitely not into melodic death metal. Right, we've come back sort of to the area where we were originally. The monkeys were shouting over there. Brent is in there on foot now with Herbert. And, you know, they can do a proper traverse of the area and maybe they'll find some tracks or maybe even whatever animal it is that they were shouting at. Them irksome monkeys. Jason Jones, you say, could it be the wind? I'm not sure I've heard from Jason Jones before. Jason Jones, if I haven't, wonderful to have a question from you. You say, could it be the wind that's affecting where I'm hearing the alarm calls from? Absolutely. Definitely, and certainly when I started hearing them, I couldn't pinpoint where they were, but I then saw the monkeys. So I could see exactly where they were, and I could see exactly where they were looking. So, you know, yeah, that there, then I didn't have to worry too much about the direction of where I was hearing the sound coming from. But yes, the wind will absolutely make a big difference. And when I was off on foot, just kind of creeping around, when that wind came up, I stopped immediately just to stop and listen and make sure that my ears were kind of readjusting to the new atmosphere. Because if you don't do that, you can find yourself blundering into something. A, because they won't hear you, and B, because you won't hear them. So in the wind, you've got to be very careful about how you walk. You've got to be very aware of which way the wind is blowing. Which of course goes back to the question of, have I ever been genuinely scared? And, you know, it's so closely tied up with how comfortable you feel in an area, and how comfortable you feel in an area is so closely tied up with how well you understand it and how well you've been trained to cope with it. And there's no question that when I started doing this job and we had to walk around, you know, on our own in the bush, it was tremendously intimidating. I found it terrifying because I'd come from the city. I knew nothing about the wild. I had some theory from university, but as most of us are coming to realize, the theory from university is great if you're reading books, but almost completely useless in practice. And so I was genuinely afraid. And as the years have gone by, and I've spent more and more time on foot in an area like this, so it is that it's become much less terrifying, and that's simply a function of understanding more about where I live. I've always maintained that anybody who comes into this area to work and doesn't feel some sense of, maybe not fear, but a sense of nervousness is deluding themselves. In the same way that were I to walk down a street in, say, the Badlands of Detroit. Oh, Ryan spotted a bird. You know, if I was to do that in complete ignorance, then I probably wouldn't be afraid. But if I was to do it knowing what the crime statistics are there, well, then I'd probably be scared. Now, that's a batelier, everybody. And just appreciate the skill that that bird has. The wind is blowing strongly now from the southeast. It's changed direction from this morning's wind as the front has hit us. And it's not easy to fly. It's gusting, it's not consistent, and that bird is making hundreds of little tiny adjustments to its feathers all the time in order to stay balanced in the air. And you can see it almost kind of losing its balance regularly. But then it makes a whole lot more unconscious, completely unconscious adjustments. Brian, there are elephants running behind us. Hang on, let me just reverse. Ah, there's a big bull elephant. It's the elephant bull that we saw this morning. He's trying to get it on, as it were, with a young cow. Oh, goodness gracious, look at this, Brian.
James.
I'm just going to call Brent. Go ahead. Yes, there can be no doubt as to what he was after. Copy that. Just go again with position. That is fascinating. Okay, copy, thanks. So, he is, Brent's just saying he's got tracks of a male leopard in the bush there somewhere. This elephant bull is in must, and he's trying to, obviously that female's probably coming into maybe her first estrus. She looks about 9 years old, and that's when they will come into their first estrus. He will harass her and irritate her and be physically very intimidating to her, but he cannot mate with her unless she wants to mate, because she has to stand still, otherwise it becomes impossible. I think that other herd, that other bull, is tracking the same herd, and he's in must. And if that other bull comes across this youngster, there's going to be trouble. I believe Jamie has a car issue that she wants to tell us about.
Well, judging by the clouds of dust that are billowing about, plus the curious noise emanating from Rusty's front right, I have concluded, also I can see, that we have acquired a passenger in the form of a very large stick that is wedged underneath the car. And so bear with me 1 second while we attempt to pull this one out. It looks very firmly wedged in there. I'm hoping that it might be easier than it looks at present. Oh, it's positively an entire tree. Oh dear. Oh. That was easier than I expected. pretty impressive branch we've been dragging along with us, leaving a very curious drag mark for some unsuspecting tracker to have to follow. Poof. Well, that should improve the dust situation somewhat. I've tried and tried to find this leopard. I think I'm going to move on for now, go and check the waterhole around the Cheetah Plains clearings, and then carry on and kind of return back in that way to circle around. It's very frustrating because I know that she's hidden there somewhere, but it could well be that in this weather, she found herself with a perfect hunting situation. Very windy, very difficult to hear, and for the same reason that I was feeling relatively nervous walking in those monkey orange thickets, for the same reason that a Dacre or a Steenbok or even an Impala might feel exactly the same. And there's a good chance that she's just hiding up somewhere in that block with a kill underneath a tree somewhere. And if I don't find her tracks coming out towards in this direction, then I'm going to jump off and go for another walk in that block. Now while we search, it seems as though James is having an elephant-filled morning, and he has more to show you.
Well, that's the cow that the bull was chasing, everybody. You can see she's young. I don't think she's more than 9 years old. And that's about the time that they might first breed. Now I'm going to wait here because I think old amorous bull is going to come knocking out of the bushes here very soon. There he is. Here he comes. He can smell her. Might have to move back, but I think he'll probably see what he does. Here he comes. Leave her alone, you nasty brute. So I'd say he's about 10 years younger than the other fellow. We may have to move fairly smartly, but let's see. No, he's going to go around the side of us. He is massive, massive, massive. How was that, Brian?
That was fantastic.
That is so cool. I think I'm going to have to take a picture of him, everyone. Lynn, you want to know those tusks get in the way of mating? No, I don't think they do, Lynn. I think that they are irrelevant to mating. Maybe if they're really big, those ones not. I'm trying to think of the other chap. Yeah, it's possible that that other chap with his enormous tusks could have a little bit of trouble in his attempts to mount, but I'm not sure that it would make a huge difference. And now, of course, the wind is blowing, you see, so he's going to struggle to smell where she's gone. But I suspect she must be, if she's not in full estrus, she must be in kind of the initial phases, because he wouldn't be harassing her like this unless he had smelt something that made him think, ooh, hello, hello, hello. They also may already have mated, of course. Decide that he's now frustrated and irritated, and so he's going to take it out on us. Don't be silly. There we go, good fellow. He saw Brian and thought, no, that chap's a bit big. Wonderful. Fantastic sighting. Now, just watch how that massive, massive animal disappears into the bush there. And Matthew, a very good question from you. How many different species are there of elephant in the Kruger National Park? Matthew, there are only two species of elephant in the world, and one of them is called a forest elephant, and they live in the Central African rainforests, and Brent has certainly had some experience with them. You can ask him about his gammy right hip, if you like. And he'll tell you about them. They don't occur here. They only occur in the deep rainforests of the Congo Basin and around there. And the rest of the elephants in the world, well, not the world, sorry, in Africa, are African elephants, Loxodonta africana. The forest elephant could well be a similar species, and we're not really sure if they actually should be designated different species or perhaps just subspecies of each other. Jamie has got a wildebeest. Let's go and see him.
Everything today is thoroughly nervous, including, I don't really know if this is Normless Norman or Normal Norman, the gnu. I know that Brent has named both wildebeest males that hang around the Cheetah Plains area. But we're in the sort of the halfway, halfway point between Gormless Norman. No. What's his name again? Oh, I've forgotten now. Gormless Norman. That doesn't make any sense. Anyway, never mind. It's one of the wildebeest males that has been guarding the territory. Normal Norman and his other one is a bit further to the south. And the two of them tolerate each other, but we found ourselves right in the middle of the no man's land between the two of them. I don't lay claim to that name. That was Brent. We're going to carry on. I'm not going to follow the wildebeest. We're going to go and see if we can't find the harrier hawk that just came flying past. A gymnogene or a harrier hawk, one of my favorite birds to watch. It was being thoroughly mobbed by a group of crested, what are they called? Lapwings. Sorry, had a serious brain freeze moment there. It's the wind. It's blowing all my thoughts straight out. Now, these two guys, along with several others, along with the Senegal lapwings, were mobbing the harrier hawk as it flew through. Oh. Hear them and the lapwings. There we go. There's the crested lapwing pottering along. Now, speaking from experience, they can be exceptionally defensive of their nests and their babies, and gymnogenes and harrier hawks are renowned and specialized nest raiders. But they made sure that that harrier hawk did not stick around in any way, shape or form, and they chased it off towards the more southern open area of the plains. So let's go and see if we can't find it. Still at the same time double checking for wherever this leopard went. Her tracks haven't come out here as far as I can tell, but with all of the animals moving backwards and forwards to the water, they might just have walked over her tracks. And we'll keep an eye out for them. And of course, whenever we come to this area, we always start to look for tracks for cheetah. We've got the two male cheetah that hang around a lot in this area. Where did you go, gymnogene? I sympathize, though, with that harrier hawk, having been attacked by the lapwings myself as a child, running through and accidentally disturbing the area where they nest. They will come down and they will peck you on the head. They've drawn blood from my head before, so I do understand its reluctance to hang around. You can hear the wind is absolutely howling out here on the plains. And I guess that's... Whoop! If you needed any further evidence, you've just seen it. I'm not even sure my hat's going to stay on for any extended period of time. And this, I think, is the beginning of the cold front on its way. Those wispy cirrus clouds on their way. Cape Town once again sending us their horrible weather. That makes us want to run and hide, and it has exactly the same effect on the animals of this area. Cheetah Plains is completely devoid of mammal life at the moment. Everything is hiding away. Kelsey, who is watching in New Zealand, welcome, oh my word, welcome to the Sunrise Safari as we yell above the sound of the wind rushing past. You wanted to know, oh my goodness, I think we better start running for the nearest dense vegetation because this is ridiculous. I feel like I'm about to blow away. Oh my word. Kelsey, it is this entire reserve, the space that is open to all of the animals, is 4 million hectares worth of, or almost 4 million hectares worth of unfenced wilderness, which is absolutely enormous. Gives them loads of room to move about. It's larger than certain small countries. It's larger than Wales in the United Kingdom. A really, really big wilderness area. It's part of the Greater Kruger National Park area. So just to the east of where we are lies the world famous Kruger National Park. And we're part of a series of private game areas that have dropped their fences and allowed themselves to be part of the Kruger National Park area. And in fact, the Greater Transfrontier National Park, because it extends into Zimbabwe and into Mozambique. The area that we can traverse is a little bit smaller than that, so we have our own section of pristine land. We cover about 2,000 hectares worth of area. Juma is 1,200, Arethusa is 800 or so, and then Cheetah Plains, which is where we are now, is 550 hectares. So altogether we can cover an area of 2,500. Now, I'm about as far southeast as we could possibly get. Any further to the south and east, I'd be in either Mala Mala or the Kruger National Park. And we definitely don't want to do that. I don't think they'd take very kindly to our presence. But those are our general traverse areas. And the wonderful thing about an area that is as large as this is that it can be allowed to exist as it would have naturally hundreds and thousands of years ago. No interference is necessary. The animals control the carrying capacity of the land controls itself. The animal population controls itself. And we have the most extraordinary sightings because of it. Now, the Sabi Sand, which is where we are, is a place that is world famous for its leopard sightings, and sightings in general, but leopard and lion sightings. And in fact, we are not too far away from an area that has the highest density of lions in Africa. Not only that, but while we're searching this southern boundary of Cheetah Plains, a place where the Cheetah Brothers love to hang out, we're also in an area that has the largest meta population of cheetah anywhere in Africa. So we're incredibly fortunate in the place that we get to be. Now, as you can tell, winter has arrived and the colors have changed completely and leaves are blowing all around us, including into the car, hitting Gert and myself. We're covered in dust. This is quite the weather brewing we have on its way. And everything, it seems, thanks to the wind, is hiding away. Now, speaking of the cold, Cindy was wondering if there are any animals out here that love it. And the answer is probably yes, actually. I would say that most of the larger animals enjoy it. The elephants in particular are far more playful, in my opinion, at this time of year. Ooh, black-bellied bustard. Cindy, I'll get back to your question in 1 second. Here's a fun bird for us to have a look at. Wandering about. We heard its cousin earlier when I stopped and talked about the fact that it is quite scary out here in this kind of weather. Come on. Just need to pop out ever so slightly. Oh, there you go. Perfect. Thank you, black-bellied bustard. Now you can see exactly where that name comes from, with the black extending all the way up underneath the chin. And this is a male. The male black-bellied bustard's much more striking. Whoopsie, did you fall over there? Just a little bit. Bit of an overbalance, overzealous reaching for food. Oh, this weather's crazy. Oh, it's definitely one of my favorite bird calls. The male does a whistle, a descending whistle, and then a champagne cork popping sound. I can't do it. I definitely can't imitate it. Brian, I think, does the best, or gives the best impression of a black-bellied bustard. A fascinating way of walking. It's almost like the head is pulling the body forward with each step. And that's very clearly an anatomical necessity. It's like us walking and swinging our arms. It's just an automatic action. Beautiful sort of subtle patterning, like the Franklins and the spur fowls. It's very useful camouflage. And with the earth as brown and tan as it is at the moment, you can see how well that would work as a camouflage method. Isn't he beautiful? Long, strong legs, immediately pointed out as the cousin of the largest flying bird in the world. That is the Cory Bustard, or at least the heaviest flying bird in the world. Now, we could see a Cory Bustard out here. I haven't yet, but it is on my wish list. And the plains of Cheetah Plains, I think particularly in summer, will be a good place to come and spot them. This is a relatively large bird, but the Cory Bustard, its cousin, can reach up to 17 kilograms, so 35 odd pounds, which makes it the heaviest flying bird. But with those long legs and very large feet, clearly gives the impression that this is a bird that spends the majority of its time walking on the ground. And there he goes. And Ayo, you were watching the way that our black-bellied bustard was walking, and you were wondering, why do birds do that when they walk? Because pigeons and doves do it as well. You're wondering if it is for balance. Probably yes, to a degree, but I think it's a muscular and skeletal structure that kind of has evolved to balance out the way that the bird walks. That forward, it almost looks like its head is pulling its body forward as it wanders along. But what I meant when I compared it to human beings is, if you walk naturally without thinking about it, because if you think about it too much, it starts to feel really strange. But when you walk, you swing your opposite arm as you walk along. And I'm pretty sure that the bird's head bobbing is exactly the same in the way that it's adapted to the physical thing. And we swing our arms partly for balance and partly because it just works that way with the contraction and the relaxation of the muscles. And the same would apply to that bird that has now disappeared. And I'm going to try and seek some shelter, I think. This wind is absolutely howling. You could see as we were watching that black-bellied bustard, the leaves skittering across the ground like that, making a great deal of noise. Now, Cindy, I was in the process of answering your question before I got distracted by that bustard. And that was whether any of the animals enjoy the cold. And of course, they're not able to tell us that, but by the behavior of the elephants, they're a lot more playful and actually quite a lot more relaxed in weather like this, because an animal that is that big does feel the heat quite badly. And you know that the elephant's ears are a fantastic air conditioning unit, with all of the blood rushing through the capillaries and blowing about. This is ridiculous, this weather. But the same applies to lions as well. Lions, as you know, have very poor methods of cooling down. It's one of the reasons why they're very inactive during the day, or very seldom active during the day. And it's because that if a lion's body temperature overheats by a degree in centigrade, then they could actually die. It's a degree and a half to a degree. They actually find themselves in serious trouble. Now, a lion would prefer weather like this. Leopards definitely do. The only thing that it means for lions and leopards is that there's a bit less in the way of cover. But again, their coat color is geared towards hiding in this kind of environment, sneaking up on things. And I'm sure that leopard watched us drive past earlier. My goodness me, it sounds as though Mr. Henry is really having an elephant-themed morning. So while we continue to go back to the place where I last had the leopard tracks for the last few moments, let's head across to James.
Yes, everybody, it is Elephant Day here on the Mahindra. Now, while we look at these elephants, of course, we have to come up with a name for our new Mahindra. And, of course, Mahindras are from India, aren't they, Brian?
They are indeed.
Now, I think, therefore, the Mahindra should have an Indian name. And I would like to suggest using the name of the great Indian cricket player, Sachin Tendulkar, possibly the greatest cricket player to ever live. So I'm going to propose the name Sachin for our Mahindra. I suppose we could just call him Mahindra, couldn't we? But Sachin is a rather good name. So tell us what you think there. Then we'll have Rusty and Wendy, Jigger and Sachin.
Or the boat.
Like we could boat. Call it the Black Pearl.
Ooh, there we go.
There we go. It's actually much better. Let's call it the Black Pearl. There's some buffalo up ahead, everyone. Let's go and look. These are two young bulls, by the way, who are just lurking on the sort of fringes of that big herd of elephants that we saw earlier on. We're just up ahead, there's a herd of buffalo. We did see our amorous bull once more. He was disappearing into some more thick bush. I say there was a herd of buffalo. I saw three or four here and assumed it was a herd. They have now, of course, disappeared. Ah, there they are. If one is going to be the Black Pearl, though, one has to be Captain Jack Sparrow. And that is going to require the wearing of makeup and talking in a slightly different way.
Captain James Finch.
Captain James Finch, yes. Here is a huge herd of buffalo. I know you've seen a herd of buffalo with Jamie. This is not the same herd. Oh, the wind doth blow, Brian, with a great enthusiasm. There are a whole lot of buffalo to our right-hand side as well. There they are. And I'm continuously amazed by the buffalo in the northern Sabi sands, which remain quite nervous of vehicles, no matter how many cars they see. I have been into buffalo sightings in the south of the Sabi sand, where you can get into them, and I mean, I had a tracker once with the most amazing sense of humor, and he slapped one of them on the backside. I mean, that's how close we got. You won't ever get that close to these ones. They're always slightly alarmed. Very clever question from James Richard asking about whether or not oxpeckers have evolved in separate niches. So we know we get two different kinds of oxpeckers here. We have the red-billed and the yellow-billed. And James, you say, is there any reason they would have evolved into two different species? James, they do have a slightly different feeding technique. If I'm not mistaken, I may get wrong which one is which. But the red-billed is a comber. It combs through the hair, so it probably takes much smaller ectoparasites, whereas the red-billed is more a pecker than it is a comber, and so it probably takes slightly larger parasites. And I think that's all it is. It definitely is a slight separation of the trophic or feeding niche. And they also live in slightly different habitats normally. We're in an overlap area here, where they tend to, you know, they both occur. The further north you go, so the more the yellow-billed replaces the red-billed. Until you get up to an area like Palabowa or north into Pafuri, where there are far more yellow-billed than there are red-billed, and they just seem to be able to cope in slightly drier areas than the red-billed does. Not sure why or what part of their physiology allows them to do that. This is a very large herd of elephants, at least buffalo. I would watch out at the Juma Dam cam. These chaps may well come past there to have a drink. I'm just going to ease forward because they're crossing the road in front of us. Don't freak out. Everybody relax. And Greg, I was talking about ectoparasites and ticks, and you want to know if ticks here carry Lyme's disease. Greg, they don't. They carry something called tick bite fever, but we don't get Lyme disease here in the same way that you do there in the United States. And so, and tick bite fever is imminently curable with just a very short course of antibiotics. So it's not nothing like as serious as Lyme's disease, which I know can be very debilitating. Amazing how the wind is blowing through the leaves and rustling. Just listen to that. That is the sound of a winter front rustling through the dry leaves. Very nice, Brian. That's very artistic.
Oh, thank you.
And Shamsun, nice one from you. Are you wondering, is it unusual that we're not seeing so many young calves? Is it the wrong time of year? It's not the wrong time of the year, but it's not the best time of the year. So Shamsun, they will breed at any time of the year, buffalo, but there is definitely a birthing peak during the height of the rainy season, and we're going into the dry season now, and so yes, you'll find that there is a marked reduction in the number of calves or little calves that we see. Oh, I'm getting dust in my eyes, Brian. And a question from a name I can't quite get, sorry, Rebecca, about whether or not buffalo live in the same herds for life. Ah, debt. That's an interesting one. I don't think I've had a question from you before, debt. Debt, you want to know if buffalo live in the same herds for life or if they change it up a bit when they get bored. Debt? You'll find that they do live in the same herds if they're females and youngsters. The males will go off and normally or live on their own for a while, or they'll go off and join another herd when they sort of reach their prime. So the females and youngsters will stay in the natal herd. But a big herd like this, remember, is not always together. A big herd like this is only this big, probably because of the winter time. And so as we go towards the driest season and the water becomes more and more concentrated, so it is that this buffalo herd, or all the buffalo herds, will get larger and larger because they start to sort of come together. So in the summer, when there's lots of water around, you'll find that they don't necessarily hang about in such big herds. They'll normally in this area be herds of sort of 50 to 100, I've found. You'll read differently, but observation would suggest 50 to 100 is about the maximum. And then when they split up again, so when this big herd splits up, I think you'll find that some will find themselves in a different herd from the one that they joined the herd in, if you know what I mean. So I don't think it's a particularly, it's not like an elephant herd where the family bonds are incredibly strong. And Abhishek, along the same lines as Chris was asking about the elephants earlier, you say, is there any indication that they will give before they charge? Well, these buffalo wouldn't charge. A herd of buffalo will almost universally run away from you unless it is set upon by lions, in which case it might then try and charge the lions. But us, they will. You can see that they're just moving away from us. They have no real sort of desire to have anything to do with us. And so I think you'll find that the chances of a herd of buffalo like this charging us is almost negligible. But yes, they will give some kind of indication. The bulls especially will indicate if they're going to charge you by grunting, and then they'll lift their heads and snort. and the herds won't, though. They'll just make a big noise. I love this question because I've thought of it so often myself. Charlotte, you're saying, are the prey animals like this, the herbivores, do they ever relax, or are they always constantly looking over their backs, wondering what's going to try and eat them? And Charlotte, I think the answer is that no, I don't think they do relax. You know, I think they are constantly on the lookout. I don't think they notice. I don't think they really know the difference anymore. You know, they've been doing it for so long, so they probably don't notice at all. But the only animal, well, the two animals that I've seen relax out in the bush, but the only animal that I've seen truly, truly chill out is a lion. They will lie down and truly go to sleep for lengthy periods and not wake up. Leopards to a lesser extent, elephant bulls can also relax, and I've seen herds, especially with young elephants, relax, but I've very seldom seen a very relaxed elephant cow. They're always on the lookout for things. And buffalo and impala and kudu and nyala and bushbuck and waterbuck and wildebeest, no, they're always terrified. I think it must be the most stressful life. Yeah, I mean, they're on the edge of trauma just about all the time, I think. A magnificent herd of buffalo. Matthew, you're wondering about a hierarchy in a vast herd of beefies like this. Do they have a hierarchy? Matthew, they do. It's not very strictly enforced, but they do definitely have a hierarchy. And what you'll find, we're right in amongst them now, this is wonderful. What you'll find is that the females have a hierarchy that, you know, is basically based on age. It's not, like I say, particularly well or definitely held or maintained, but it is definitely there. And the bigger females will be the ones that lead the herd when they move. The bulls definitely have a hierarchy, and that is enforced. But that's simply over mating opportunities that they have a hierarchy. It's not like it's nothing like the hierarchy in a hyena clan, where each one's got a sort of stratified position within the group. And the female one, I think, is based largely on age. I don't think it's enforced with too much violence. But the bulls are pretty violent with each other. Now, Avishek, another nice one from you about color blindness, and you say, are buffalo blind? At least color blind. Avishek, yes, I imagine they are color blind, but remember, color blindness is a relative term. It doesn't mean they see in black and white, they see in various sort of shades of red and green, as far as I'm aware. And also, you must be aware that they, you know, some are more color blind than others. So while some will be colorblind, at least some animals are colorblind completely, something like a lion, I think you'll find that the color vision on a buffalo herd like this is probably that much better than it is in something like a lion. So they don't see in black and white, and that's an important thing to realize. Let's carry on a bit. This is an entertaining herd of buffalo, isn't it, Brian? getting a very kind of pale wintry sky now. And that's because of the wind. All right, let's leave these buffalo. They're going into some thickish bush. We'll let them relax there. Let's go and find out what's happening with those tracks on cheetah plains.
Well, Gert and myself have managed to escape the worst of the wind and made our way all the way up to the northern boundary of cheetah plains. I'm sort of in my head tossing up the idea that if we were tracking in Kanyeni, a lot of her territory is on Nkoro. So we're currently driving the boundary between Nkoro and Cheetah Plains. It's a bit of a stretch because her general direction was south, not north. Then at the same time, I've been doing some thinking about the tracks that we saw at the very beginning when we first started tracking. And I'm convinced that those were male tracks. So at some point, maybe or maybe not, the female leopard and the male leopard met up last night and then went in their different directions. That's pretty standard leopard behavior. If the female's not in estrus and she happens to encounter the male that's in the area, she might have had a good sniff. He might have had a good sniff and then off they go, their separate ways. Leopards are not sociable creatures unless they are either in estrus or mating or with a cub or two. I think that might have been what had happened. And that there's also a male somewhere here, and I think the male might have moved off further north towards Nkoro. But at least we found ourselves a good place to start, unless she pops out right now. We found ourselves a good place to start for the sunset safari, and hopefully she decides to come out of that awful, awful block that she wandered into. It just made tracking her so difficult in that monkey orange thicket. And even if we had found her, getting to her would have been a different story altogether. But perhaps she might decide this afternoon that she's thirsty, come out for a drink, or something similar. This is perfect leopard hunting weather, with this wind howling like this. And a very warm welcome before we come to the end of our sunrise safari to a new viewer, John Chang, who was wondering whether or not we can see his comments. We can. And welcome to our live safaris. I hope that you will find yourself as addicted as some of our other viewers have found themselves. We are on every day, twice a day, for 3 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the afternoon. I'm not sure exactly where you're watching from, John, but you will be able to see us twice a day. Unless something goes wrong with our stream, but that very seldom happens. I welcome you to our safari, and I beg you to keep on watching and to tell all of your friends about these live safaris. The more viewers we get, the more extraordinary things we will be capable of accomplishing. So it's fantastic to have you on board, and I look forward to sharing some of the stories of our most famous animal characters, from the lions to the leopard that evaded us this morning. I haven't given up yet though. There's still a few minutes, there's still a few moments. She might just pop out. You never know. The joy about these live safaris, John, and to any other new viewers, is that they are live, which means we can't plan and we certainly can't script. We cannot edit or change the facts. We show you exactly what is happening and we try and share what we guess has happened while we've been away. It's probably the truest reflection of wildlife in this area that you will ever be able to watch. And the joy, of course, is that people from around the world can watch from the comfort of their armchair or couch or sturdy, ergonomically designed, back-supporting study chair and watch us track leopards and lions and all kinds of wonderful things. And we'll just have to try again. At least we're not starting from scratch this afternoon, but we will have to try again and see if we can't figure out where these leopards have gone. And of course, which leopard we were tracking, because it's right on the boundary of Tundi and in Kanyeni's territory. I'm not sure. never seen in Kanyeni, or at least I've never seen it. Exactly how large her tracks are. I have seen Tundi, and her tracks look to be about that size, or the size of the leopard we were tracking. We're about to go through a bit of a signal dip, so while we do that, James has found another of our wonderful creatures, a warthog.
Here be some piggies, everybody. And it's quite a nice large sounder, and we came back to the area that's exactly where we saw the dwarf mongoose earlier. And I was kind of hoping that there might be that male leopard that Brent saw the tracks of somewhere around here. Anyway, no leopard, pigs. Pigs are good, aren't they, Brian?
Pigs are great.
Everyone likes pigs.
I love pigs.
And they really are not normally that relaxed around us here. So it is quite nice to have them as they are. They will be very weary. Hello, Adam, you're a new viewer, and that's lovely to have you with us. You want to know which animals are becoming endangered in this area. Adam, you know, we're in a place called the Kruger National Park, and the Kruger National Park generally is, you know, has had a fairly steady state of affairs for quite a long time. So no animals are becoming endangered here so much. There are animals that used to be here that aren't here in such great numbers anymore, and there are animals that are endangered everywhere that do occur here. So in terms of the former, you know, animals that are sort of reducing in their numbers but aren't necessarily endangered, I suppose the roan, sable and eland would be the most obvious ones. Those are antelope species, and they don't occur in the same numbers that they used to here, largely because of water provision by human beings. And then endangered species that actually occur here that, you know, are endangered everywhere would be African wild dogs, of course, the famous painted wolf of Africa. And then also, cheetah occur here, they're also pretty endangered. And black rhino is the other obvious one. The black rhino is a highly endangered animal, and they do occur here from time to time. But in terms of something going sort of extinct over here, no, I think we're okay on that score. But welcome, Adam. Lovely to have you with us, and I hope that you will continue to watch and mainly continue talking to us, because it is so very good to hear from all of you from all over the world. Astounding that we're able to do this. Avishek, you want to know if warthogs are extremely defensive if you're close to them. They can be, but they also tame, you know. They tame really well. So at some lodges, you'll find warthogs on the sort of lawns. And they come up and they eat the fresh grass on the lawns, and you can get pretty close to them. And if you adopt a young one as a piglet, they tame readily. And they will sort of be like a pet, pretty much. So they're not that defensive. But if you happen to trap one of them, say in its termite mound by mistake, you can get into a lot of trouble. And you do hear stories of people being knocked over by warthog, given a fright that come bursting out of their burrows in a termite mound, and they knock people over. They wouldn't maul them, but they would do some damage. The wind really is starting to blow now. As Brian was saying, probably a windy afternoon followed by a very chilly Sunday morning tomorrow. Not so, Brian.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Very freezing. Well, we've hardly had a winter so far, so I suppose we should expect one at some stage. Not entirely unusual to have winter every year, is it, Brian?
Not that unusual.
No, it's normal. We often have winter. And Nature's Darling, you're asking about the parenting of warthogs, and you want to know if an orphaned warthog would be looked after by others. I'm going to say that I think they probably would, you know. If I'm not mistaken, warthogs do cross-suckle. So, you've got a sounder here. Let's just take the binoculars out and see exactly what the social makeup is here. You know, warthog sows will often be sort of in pairs, and they'll have babies at a similar time. And then I think that they, if I'm not mistaken, they do cross-suckle. And so I think, yes, it's well possible. If it's a very small piglet, I think you'll find that it will die. But if it's sort of this size of piglet, well, they're obviously weaned, so they will be fine. They will just carry on with the sounder. But I do think that warthogs will cross-suckle. And so that's what we've got in the front. And then right at the back, lying down now, having a snooze, is the big boar. That's a big male. And I'm just scanning the bushes around here. Scanning the bushes around here for spotted pelage of a male leopard. Hello, Lion Eyes from Texas. I see that you are particularly concerned about Hoppy. Hoppy, of course, is Jandre's new name because he's managed to damage his foot again, and you want to know if he's managed to seek medical attention. Yes, we sent him to the doctor yesterday. The doctor gave him 7 kilograms of various medications to take, which we are hoping is going to solve the problem. If it doesn't, I have offered to cut his foot off for him. He looked a little terrified and went into his room after that happened. But we think he's going to be okay. Now, of course, we need him to be okay for next week, because on Saturday and Sunday next week, we have our TV shows, our Father's Day specials, and that'll be going out on National Geographic Wild to the United States television. We're going to be stars, Brian. Right, that's it from us, everybody. Thank you very much for coming along. I'm going to say a fond farewell from Jamie on the other vehicle. She's being filmed by Gert at the moment. They're on their way back from Cheetah Plains, so they don't have any signal. Thank you, Brian, for your efforts today. Big, well done. Big thanks to Rebecca in the final control with Louise. Mostly, of course, to all of you for your questions and comments during this rather pleasant morning. That's the thumb, everyone. We'll see you later at 3 o'clock. Bye-bye.